भाई गवर्नमेंट डिग्री कॉलेज ठाठी। गवर्नमेंट डिग्री कॉलेज ठाठी इज लोकेटेड इन द चन्हा वैली रीजन एफिलिएटेड टू जम्मू यूनिवर्सिटी यूटी ऑफ जम्मू एंड कश्मीर। एस्टेब्लिश्ड इन 2011। ऑल ऑफ यू आर गेटिंग मी?
यस
सर। ओके, नाउ फॉर द फर्दर प्रोसीडिंग्स ऑफ द वेबिनार आई वुड लाइक टू हैंड ओवर माइक टू एन इमिनेंट पर्सनैलिटी प्रिंसिपल गवर्नमेंट डिग्री कॉलेज ठाठरी बशारत इकबाल सर। सर आर यू हियरिंग मी? हेलो सर, बशारत सर आर यू हियरिंग मी? हेलो,
It seems the audio of sir is not working yet.
ओके वेट। हेलो,
बशारत सर हैज़ नॉट कनेक्टेड हिज ऑडियो प्रॉपरली.
वेट वेट। हेलो बशार सर आर यू हियरिंग मी?
No, see, Basharat sir's audio is not connected. Anuj, you may go ahead and we will start the proceedings, I think, because people are waiting.
ओके 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 ओके
Wait a second, I think his audio has been connected. Yes, his audio has been connected. You can.
बशार सर आर यू हियरिंग मी? हेलो हेलो बशार सर आर यू हियरिंग मी?
No, no, he is not.
Okay, I will continue, sir. Okay, now today
Anuj, put yourself on mute.
I have unmuted. Okay, for today's webinar, we have with us an expert from Baba Ghulam Shah University, Mr. Tanveer Ahmed, Assistant Professor, hailing from Baba Ghulam Shah University, Rajouri, UT of Jammu and Kashmir. He had many publications and also expertise in computer and many other applications. He possesses diverse knowledge, being a student of the literature. Now, I would like to welcome.
Anuj, you have muted yourself back.
Now the topic of today's webinar is deconstruction and its application. Now I would like to hand over mic to Assistant Professor Tanveer Ahmed for the further proceedings and being a speaker of today's webinar. Sir, I welcome you.
Thank you. Thank you, Anuj. It is very unfortunate that we have not been able to connect with the principal Government Degree College Thartree, Mr. Basharat Iqbal sir. As all of you know that most of the people who are engaging in this webinar are on 2G network, so it becomes very difficult. We have all these inconveniences, but we hope that in the meanwhile he would join us, and he would join us with proper audio. Till then, we would not like to keep people on the wait. We would be beginning the proceedings, unfortunately, without the permission of Honorable Principal, Government Degree College, Thartree. One thing that I'd like to say here is, Mr. Basharat Iqbal, sir, who is Principal, Government Degree College, Thartree, I am one of the students of his. As a student of college, he taught me English literature, and his influence was such that it made me a lecturer in English literature, and now an assistant professor in English literature. Now, coming to the today's webinar, what we would be dealing with is deconstruction and its application on text. I would request here coordinator of this event, Anuj Kumar, to admit people, since I won't be able to do this side by side as I'll be delivering a talk. And I also hope that my audio is audible to everyone who is participating in this webinar. Now, the title is Deconstruction and its Application on a Text. Now, when it comes to the deconstruction, it's a theory, it's a literary theory, which is very much relevant to the students of English literature and to the faculty of English literature, those who have been teaching in various departments, whether they teach in a university or whether they teach in a college. Deconstruction is one of the various literary theories that most of the scholars of English literature, whether they are pursuing MPhil or they are pursuing PhD or they are writing a research, are supposed to apply these theories. One more request that I would like to make here is that all those participants who are part of this webinar, I request them to mute their audio so that no disturbance happens during the presentation. Now, coming to the presentation of today's webinar, let's begin with introducing deconstruction. What is deconstruction and how did it start? Well, deconstruction started after structuralism. Most of the people who are from the background of English literature know about structuralism and they know about deconstruction. Structuralism is a theory which we associate mostly with Ferdinand de Saussure, who, during his times talked about the structurality of the universe, or how a meaning is given to the life, to the human beings, the text, to our language, through a proper structure. But after the structuralism, what we had immediately post that was deconstruction, which we affiliate mostly with Jacques Derrida. Now, what is deconstruction about? How did it start? Now, here is an important fact about deconstruction, that it had a very interesting beginning. Now, how did deconstruction begin? It began with a research paper which was presented by Jacques Derrida in an international conference, and he titled that paper as Sign, Structure and Play in the Discourses of Human Sciences. Now, Sign, Structure and Play in the Discourse of Human Sciences is a very common writing, very common research paper, which is mostly published in the syllabi of post-graduation in most of the universities. So I believe and I assume that most of the people who are from literature background and are part of this webinar are well aware about this paper, Sign, Structure and Play in the Discourse of Human Sciences. Now, this paper was presented at a conference that was titled The Language of Criticism and the Sciences of Man, which was held at John Hopkins University in Baltimore from 18th to 21st of October 1996. Now, what was important about this conference was that this conference was attended by some of the great personalities of that period and whom we know as great critics also afterwards, like we had Paul D. Mann, who is a famous deconstructionist theorist. He attended this conference, and this conference was also attended by Jack Slarka. This conference was attended by Jacques Derrida. However, an important aspect of this presentation was that Jacques Derrida was not supposed to attend this conference. I hope my audio is audible to all.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Now, Jacques Derrida was not supposed to be, part of this conference, but he was a last-minute replacement. And one of the important personalities who seemed to be missing in this conference was, Michel Foucault. Michel Foucault is another important theorist of his era. And why does deconstruction have an interesting beginning is because it started through a conference which was supposed to be about structuralism and making structuralism famous. So that is very strange. The organizers of this conference thought that we will be conducting a conference on structuralism, which back then was a new field. So they wanted to introduce structuralism to the whole world. And it ended up bringing an end to the structuralist thought and to the beginning of deconstruction, to the beginning of deconstruction ideology. And deconstruction ideology was all about Jacques Derrida. Now, as I move ahead, I would be, changing the slides also, as I have already discussed this. Anuj, I would just request you to admit the people so that I may not have to, disturb myself. Now, what Derrida did in this conference, which the paper he wrote, Science, Structure and Play in the Discourses of Human Sciences, he took on structural ideology. Structural ideology believed that this universe, consists of a proper structure, and that structure is governed by a center. Now, if you go back to the modernist thought or to the modernism, we believe that the center of that structure was God. The meaning that we derived, the structure of the society that we had, the relations that we had, the ideas that we had, in one way or other would lead us to religious ideology. And that religious ideology would spring from God. So God would be very central in the laws of human beings, in the language of human beings, in the meaning of human beings, in the way they communicate, in the way they live. So that was structure. And this structure was very fixed. It was very narrow. There was no scope for anything that was outside the structure. Or if there was anything that was outside the structure, we would call that absurd back then. But when Derrida came up, he would one by one break all these signifieds, and he would break the structure also. Just like Ferdinand de Saussure, he broke the two views. He broke his ideas, or he talked about his ideas by discussing the language. Now, language was an important component of discussion to the structuralist as well as to the deconstructionist. If they were supposed to be, talking about the human society, how human society lives, what human society does, how we get the meaning, so we compose of language. Language is what gives us identity. Language is what gives us meaning. Language is what gives us, structure. Ferdinand de Saussure also talked about language. And Jacques Derrida would also be talking about language in his theory. Ferdinand de Saussure believed that language is a very simple thing. And I hope that most of the participants who are in this, webinar, they understand that language is a simple thing. I am communicating with most of you, and you believe whatever I am saying, is being easily communicated, and you understand what I say. But strangely, Derrida begins by saying that language is not a simple tool of communication. Now, that is very important. He says that if you believe that language is simple, it's not simple. It's not a thing that can be easily comprehended. But human beings, since times immemorial, believe that language is a tool which we understand easily. We can speak any language. I am talking to you in English. You may know Sarazi, you may know Dogri, you may speak Hindi, you may speak Urdu, you may speak Kashmiri, you can speak any language. And you assume that the language you speak, the language that I speak, is very simple. But Derrida takes a different stance regarding language when he says that it's not simple. Now, why is language not a simple? I would just give an example from Derrida's perspective. You know, here is a sentence, this is a beautiful road. Now, I assume that every one of you understand that this is a beautiful road. Now, what could be different in it? What could be, not simple about this sentence? Now, let me tell you what Derrida tells. He says that if we want to malign this sentence and if we want to think differently, we will not be able to understand it that in that simple way. For example, someone would say that, in Urdu we say, ye rasta bahut khoobsurat hai. But Derrida goes beyond that. He says that when a speaker utters a sentence, speaks a word, what does he mean? Now, if he's saying this road is beautiful, does it mean that he has not seen a beautiful road ever and he saw this road and just, exclaimed out of awe that this is a beautiful road? Or Derrida says, putting stress on the word beautiful, is this person, this speaker, telling us something about beautiful? That what beautiful means, and he is relating it to this road and making us understand that this is a beautiful road. He would go a step ahead by saying that has he or she not seen a beautiful road? Or is the person who is saying that this is a beautiful road comparing this road to another road which may not be as beautiful as this? So what Derrida says that if we go behind the intention of the speaker and look at the tune of the speaker and focus on particular words, we will see that we do not have a signified. This sentence does not simply say that this is a beautiful road. It could have, many things in it. So what Derrida does, he, destabilizes the meaning that, most of us believed in. What Derrida did at the very beginning, he removed the center. Now, as I said, in structuralist thought, there was center, and center was an important aspect of human life or structure. What Derrida did, he removed the structure, and he says that structure, if any, has to have a center. That if we need a structure, or if we have a structuralist ideology, or we follow structuralism, in that case, it must have a center. But he says, if there is center, it restricts free play within the structure. He says that if we have a structure and it is centered around God, then let me tell you, if I say this road is beautiful, it only means this road is beautiful. We cannot play with this sentence. We have to restrict ourselves to this meaning only. So that is a negative aspect, of this center. So Derrida also said that if we have a structure, it would, avoid or ignore or restrict the free play. And he says that if a structure has no center, not a structure. Now that is very important. Excuse me. If we do not have a center in, then we don't have a structure. Now, what he is actually doing, he is trying to break the structure. That is why he is saying all these arguments. Structure has to have a center. If there is a center, there is no free play. And if there is no center, there is no structure. And then he goes on to say this, which I would be quoting from the very same text which I referred earlier, Sign, Structure and Play. He says, thus, it has always been thought that the center, which is by definition unique, constituted that very thing within a structure which governs the structure while escaping structurality. This is why classical thought concerning structure could say that center is paradoxically within the structure and outside it. The center is at the center of the totality, and yet, since the center does not belong to the totality, is not part of the totality. The totality has its center elsewhere. The center is center. Now, what he is actually saying, as I said earlier, a structure had to have a center. And in modern time, center was God. But all of us believe that God is something that is beyond our existence. We make him part of our life. We make him part of our structure. We make him center of everything. But then we believe that it is something which is outside the society. Now, if there is a center which governs everything and then strangely lies outside the totality or outside the structure, then there is no center. Now, if there is no center, there is no structure. If there is no structure, there is no defined meaning. So this is how Derrida, through his work, would remove the center. Next, what he does, he removes signified. Now, let me explain briefly about signified. What is signified? Signified is the final meaning of a word. Say, for example, if I utter here in front of you Tanveer Ahmed, all of you would relate this word to me. Now, since all of you are relating this word to me, that is signified. Or if I say tree and all of you would think about a tree, that you think about a tree is signified. That signified was a concept which was given by Ferdinand de Saussure. And he, gave us this formula, which I would be showing you on your screen: sign, signifier, and signified. Now, sign is tree. What is tree? T-R-E-E. This is a sign. Now, if you put these four alphabets in front of a person who does not English language, for him it would be mere sign, which would mean nothing. But since you and me know about English language, so this sign becomes tree. Now, when we put this tree together and pronounce it as tree, it becomes a signifier. But when an image comes in our head, and that is the image of a tree, a final image of a tree, that is where it reaches signified. And what Derrida did, he just did away with this signified. He says that there is no thing like a signified. How? Now, I'll be giving you another example. Here I have written rose. R-O-S-E would be a sign, and rose is a signifier. But Derrida says that if you utter this rose in front of, say, for example, 10 or 20 people, now, do you think all of them would think about rose? Derrida says no, they'll not think about rose. The signifier in their mind will not only be rose. He says someone may think about red rose. He says someone may think about white rose. He says someone may think about rose water. Someone may think about Rose, which is a name of a girl, name of someone's sister, name of someone's wife, name of someone's friend. Someone may think about Rose, which is title of a novel which he has recently read. So what happens in Derrida's idea is that a rose does not reach to signify it, but it has multiple signifiers. Now, these multiple signifiers led Derrida to talk about it, or coin a term called difference. Now, by difference, he says that we should delay the meaning. We should not say that rose means rose. Rather, we should leave it to the listener whether he understands it as rose, or as red rose, or as white rose, or as rose water, or as rose name, or as novel. I would just request, there is someone, Bhupinder Singh, I think his audio is not on mute. So I would request him to, mute his audio. Thank you. Now, I'll give you an example of a, very famous saying, how this signified is broken. And that is, time flies like an arrow. Now, if I say this time flies like an arrow, most of you will understand what I mean by this is time flies swiftly. I don't think there would be a single person in this webinar who would think otherwise. Most of you would think that time flies like an arrow means time flies swiftly. But if we follow Derrida's idea, let me show you how things change. Now, if we, say time flies swiftly, in this case, time is noun, flies is verb, and like an arrow is an adjective clause. Now, in this syntactic form, this, sentence would mean time flies swiftly. But, let's just change, these things. Say, for example, there is a person, when he heard this saying, time flies like an arrow, he thought time as verb rather than as noun. And he thought flies as noun rather than as verb. Now, as he does this little tweaking here, suddenly the meaning of this whole sentence becomes time the flies like you time an arrow. I hope you understand. Now, time, if it becomes verb, it would mean stopwatch. I hope that you have used the stopwatch. Say, for example, someone is, pulling the string of a bow and, pushing an arrow through, and he is timing it on a stopwatch to see that how much time that arrow takes to reach a particular destination. That would mean how timing the arrow is. But now, if the same person has to do that timing with the fly, say for example a fly, which is an insect, it flies from a particular place, and he times him on the stopwatch to see that how much time would this fly take to fly from one point to another point. So what we have a person is saying to someone, assigning a task to him, ke tum kya karo, tum makhiyon ko time karo waise jaise ki tum ek arrow ko time karte ho. Now suddenly a slight shift in the syntactic form of a sentence makes us to think about a sentence differently. Now that is not all. Say for example, you have spoken this time flies like an arrow in front of a person, and he mistakenly hears time flies as butterflies. You understand, time flies butterflies could get mixed up. So he thinks that it's time flies, it's not time flies. So he takes them together, and suddenly time flies becomes a noun and like an arrow becomes an adjective. And the meaning of this so-called simple sentence would be time flies like an arrow. Ke unko arrow pasand hai. Now this is how Derrida says that language is not simple, language is not reliable tool of communication. If we want to put a play in it, we can end up playing with anything that we assume to be very simple. Now this is how from a structuralist idea we removed or we changed the ideas like signified into the difference. Now there are some important concepts, subjects, Derrida, which I would just be going through before I take up the application of deconstruction. Now he talks about aporia. Aporia is an important concept given by Jacques Derrida, which is about this internal contradiction or this difficulty in understanding the text. As I gave you an example of time flies like an arrow, or this is a beautiful road, how we can create that difficulty, or how there is a difficulty inherent, but only if anyone sees that. There is another concept of Derrida, difference, which means delaying of meaning. This was a replacement for this word called signified, and where he said that we should not reach to a signified, but we should rather delay the meaning. There is another idea of him, that is bricolage. Now this bricolage is a concept which means playing with language. What Derrida believed, as he said, that language is not a simple tool of communication. Now if language is not a simple tool of communication, what should we do? Derrida says we cannot change it because we do not have another tool. Since we do not have another tool, let's take up bricolage. Now through bricolage we can manage to use this age-old redundant language in a new way. And what is that new way? Unfortunately, Jacques Derrida also was not having that new way. So he came up with a term and called it under erasure. Now in under erasure, he tells you and me about the method that we can employ in using an old word in a new way, which is very bizarre. I hope you would also find that bizarre. Now let me give an example. Here I am giving an example of tree. Now Derrida says, how can we use this tree in a new way? He says, just put a cross over it. Now, since I have put a cross over it, now this putting cross over the word tree is using an old word in a new way, which, as I said earlier, is a bizarre kind of a concept. But then this is, you know, this would give us a creative way. Now we can, you know, use words differently. I hope that if we put a little bit of energy into it, we may find some ways. And of late, you know, we have been able to do so. Now, that was about deconstruction. Now, what deconstruction does, it destabilizes everything. It deconstructs everything. As you find it from the name deconstruction, there is a construction which you have to deconstruct, you know, or destroy. So what deconstruction does is, you know, it destroys. Now, coming to the application of this deconstruction, just a general rule that I would be saying for everyone, you know, if you are going to pursue PhD or you are going to pursue MPhil, you will have to apply theory. So there are people, you know, who would often be confused about application of theory when they say, how do I apply a theory? So just an important tip in this regard is that whatever theory you are applying on a text, whether it be deconstruction, structuralism, you know, post-colonial, Marxism, feminism, queer theory, psychoanalytic theory, whatever theory it be, you must be aware about the fundamental of that theory. So when it comes to the fundamental of deconstruction, what fundamentally deconstruction does, it destabilizes the meaning. Doesn't it? You know, it destabilized the meaning of this road is beautiful. It destabilized the meaning of, you know, time flies like an arrow. It would destabilize, it destabilized the structure. It destabilizes everything. So what deconstruction does is it destabilizes meaning. Now, if we have to apply deconstruction on a text, what we also have to do, we have to attempt in destabilizing the meaning of a text. What would this lead to? This would lead to, you know, creativity of ours, to improve upon the creativity of ours. Now, what I would be doing, I would be applying the deconstruction theory on a poem by Robert Frost titled as Mending Wall. Why have I chosen this Mending Wall? Because this is a famous poem, and you know, it is also prescribed in most of the universities at PG level. So it would be better that I assume that most of the people are there who are aware about this poem. But before I apply the theory on this poem, I would like to read the text, because what is important in the context of this poem is, first up, we have to understand the, you know, stabilized meaning of this poem, are, you know, what you call the central idea or the central theme. So let me go through this poem before we take the application. The poem reads, something there is that doesn't love a wall, that sends the frozen ground swell under it and spills the upper boulders in the sun and makes gaps even two can pass abreast. The work of hunters is another thing. I have come after them and made repair, where they have left not one stone on a stone, but they would have the rabbit out of hiding to please the yelping dogs, the gaps I mean. No one has seen them made or heard them made, but at spring mending time, we find them there. I let my neighbor know beyond the hill, and on a day we meet to talk the line and set the wall between us again, once again. We keep the walls between us as we go, to each the boulders that have fallen to each, and some are lows and some so nearly balls. We have to use a spell to make them balance. Stay here where you are until our backs are turned. We wear our fingers rough with handling them. Oh, just another kind of outdoor game. Ah, one on a side. It comes to little more. There, where it is, we do not need the wall. He is all pine and I am apple orchard. My apple trees will never get across and eat the coons under his pines, I tell him. He only says, good fences make good neighbors. Spring is the mischief in me, and I wonder if I could put a notion in his head, why do they make good neighbors? Isn't it where there are cows, but there are no cows? But before I built a wall, I would ask to know what I was walling in or walling out, and to whom I was like to give offense. Something there is that doesn't love a wall, that I wants it down, that wants it down. I could say elves to him, but it's not elves exactly, and I would rather he said it for himself. I see him there bringing a stone grasped firmly by the top in each hand like an old stone savage arm. He moves in darkness, as it seems to me, not of woods only and the shade of trees. He'll not go behind his father's saying, and he likes having thought of it so well. He says again, good fences make good neighbors. Now that was the text of the poem. Now, after going through this poem, I hope that if you have understood by the recitation of this poem, that what is this poem about? Now, if you have read this poem, most of you know, if you put it on Google, Mending Wall Summary or Mending Wall Themes, you know, you will find a million search results, and each result would be saying that it is about tradition versus a non-tradition. It's about mending wall between, you know, neighbors. So, there is a person, you know, who speaks about mending a wall, and there's a person who says that we should not mend a wall. So it is about conformity with tradition versus non-conformity with tradition. Say, for example, the first verse says that there is something that doesn't like a wall. And, the other statement made by the other speaker is good fences make good neighbors. Now, both these verses are contradictory in nature. So what they say, one person who does not conform with tradition and the other person, he conforms with tradition. Now, that is a simple, tension or idea in this particular poem, that is conformity with tradition versus non-conformity with tradition. Now, we must be very sure about it. If we are applying deconstruction, we must be sure that the tension or the central theme or the idea or the stable meaning of a text that we have thought of is stable. I would request this Rakesh Sharma, I think he has his audio on, to mute his audio. Rakesh Sharma. So in order to get an idea the meaning that we have finally looked up is stable, we need to look upon some ideas or evidences from the text. See, one of the evidence that I have taken here is, as speaker says, we should not mend the wall, but his neighbor insists on mending it. Now that is one of the idea from where we get that this should be the main idea theme of this poem. But moving ahead, let's talk about non-conformity first. How do we believe that non-conformity of the tradition is an important aspect of this poem? So here is an example. For example, the speaker says, my apple trees will never get across and eat the coons under his pines. In Urdu I would say, yaar mere seb ke drakhat कौन सा उठ के तेरे बाग में जाके कून्स खाएंगे, वो तो नहीं जा रहे हैं. अगर वो वहां नहीं जा रहे हैं तो वाई वी नीड दिस ट्रेडिशन, यू अंडरस्टैंड, वाई शुड वी बिल्ड ए वॉल, देर इज नो नीड ऑफ बिल्डिंग ए वॉल. सो दिस पर्सन, दिस स्पीकर इज टॉकिंग अबाउट नॉन कन्फर्मिटी, वी डोंट नीड सच अ ट्रेडिशन ऑफ बिल्डिंग वॉल्स. And at another place he says that these are required when we have cows, but we do not have cows here. So if we do not have cows, why do we need wall? But then he says, in the very first verse, he said that something is there that doesn't love a wall, and that sends the frozen ground swell under it and spills the upper boulders in the sun. Another argument he says that why we should not conform with the tradition is because there is some other than me also who does not like this wall. And who is he? We don't know. But there is a verse in this poem where he says, "Sipring is mischief in me." Now, this verse is again spoken by the speaker of this poem. And when he talks about sipring, he associates himself with nature. So assuming that he is being supported by the nature, so who sends The frozen ground swell, we may believe that nature sends the frozen ground swell and breaks that wall, and that is the reason why they have to go back and mend that wall. Now, these are some of the evidences from the poem which make us sure that one of the theme of this poem is non-conformity about building a wall, about mending a wall, or mending a wall taken as a metaphor would be tradition. Now, since this becomes one, the other one is automatically confirming with the tradition, wherein the other speaker, about whom we do not hear much, he says, good fences make good neighbors. Now, having done that, let's now deconstruct this binary division or this major idea of the poem, that it is about the tradition and about not abiding by the tradition, about confirming the tradition and about not conforming with the tradition. Now, how do we do that? Now, how do we do that? Again, we'll go back to, you know, this poem and find out evidences that why is there seriously any evidence which is absolutely unambiguous, which is absolutely clear about non-conformity with the tradition. Now, an important thing that I want to tell you here, deconstruction does not take into account the objectivity, because deconstructionists believe everything that is objective or everything that we call is objective has a subjective element in it. Therefore, deconstructionists believe that most of the things or ideas or words are subjective in nature. Now, here we have to believe, if the speaker says that we should have non-conformity with his tradition, we will find him, he is very subjective. Why? Because he is alone in this poem who believes that we should not mend a wall. Because he does not give us a single straightforward evidence or reference which says that he doesn't love a wall. But he says twice in the poem, something there is that doesn't like a wall, that doesn't love a wall. This something shows that even the person who takes up this side of non-conformity with the tradition is not sure about the support that he will get from. He uses the word something. He also does not use the word someone. You know, someone would refer to maybe a person, maybe a group of people, maybe some center, but he doesn't do that. He uses the word something. Now, when he uses the word something, you know, it brings into account that ambiguity in it, that less clarity in it. He is not sure, as he says, that sends the frozen ground swell under it and spills the upper boulder in the sun. Who does this? We don't know. Even he himself, the speaker, does not know. So he seems to be an individual who is thinking that something doesn't like a wall, so something doesn't want, you know, conformity with the tradition, but there is no evidence who that someone is. Now look, there is another thing he says. The work of hunters is another thing. He believes that hunters may have brought this wall down. But he says, I have come after them and made repair, where they have left not one stone on a stone. But they would have the rabbit out of hiding to please the yelping dogs. Now, even if hunters, you know, broke this wall, they did not break this wall in order to break a tradition, that they were not conforming with the tradition. That is why they broke that wall. No. He himself says that they must be looking for a rabbit. So in order to get rabbit out of the hole, in order to feed their dog, they might have broken this. They might have broken this, wall. But there is no clear-cut evidence about the non-conformity with tradition beyond what the speaker has to say, with a lot of ambiguity in his mind when he chooses the word like something. And then there is another thing he says, something there is that doesn't love a wall. Again, he uses the word something, not sure. So we must also not be sure that non-conformity of the tradition is an important aspect of this poem. There is a lot of ambiguity in the speaker who is speaking about non-conformity, about whom we thought that he takes up non-conformity. He says that wants it down. I could say else. Now see, he's talking about something else. You know, कौन है जिसको वॉल पसंद नहीं है? I would think of elves. Elves? You know, elves are the supernatural things. It associates it with magic. Who are these elves? Now, if we go back to the tradition of this English literature and English, you know, black magic tradition, we find elves are these supernatural elements about whom we are told okay, you know, they are the ones who bring mischief to the people. Now, if they bring mischief to the people, it means their intention is not the breaking of, you know, the tradition. They are not, you know, non-conforming with the tradition. They are just, you know, breaking the wall because they want a mischief. Now, if it is so, there is not a single person who supports the argument of our speaker that something there is that doesn't love a wall. Even elves don't, as he himself says. But it's not elves exactly. Now, what we find that if we say that non-conformity with the tradition is an important aspect of this poem, but what on that the speaker, I would request to Muhammad Shaukat to mute his audio. His audio is on unmute. Please mute your audio. Now, what we found that the person who was speaking for non-conformity of tradition in this poem seems to be at sixes and sevens. He doesn't have a clear-cut evidence about why does he say that non-conformity of tradition. Is it seriously about non-conformity of tradition? And then most important aspect of it is he himself mends the wall, doesn't he? He just thinks about non-conformity of tradition. He just thinks about not mending the wall. He just thinks about telling his, you know, neighbor that we should not mend the wall. But he does mend the wall. So he, being a spokesperson for non-conformity of tradition, is full of doubts. Now, if he is full of doubts, we also do not, you know, have that restriction to restrict ourselves to the notion that it's about non-conformity of tradition versus conformity of tradition. Now, we have broken down the non-conformity side of the poem. Next, we'll deconstruct, you know, these are the things which I have already spoken. Now, we'll talk about the other side, that is conformity side. You know, we said earlier that the binary division in this poem, basic tension would be non-conformity with tradition with conformity with tradition. And the conformity with tradition comes from good fences make good neighbor. He says, you know, if we are traditional, if we are with tradition, if we make fences, they make good neighbors. But is that true? You know, these are only two verses in this long poem spoken by the other speaker, or, you know, the addressee in the poem. That is, good fences make good neighbor, because they come in inverted commas and our speaker tells us that these are the words of my neighbor. So we assume that that particular neighbor is conforming with the tradition. But if he is doing so, conforming with the tradition, now is this seriously true that good fences make good neighbor? Now let me tell you, once the fence is made, the two neighbors never meet. Now think about the poem. Think about the poem. If you think about the poem, the speaker told us that both of us meet at Spring. Why do we meet at Spring? To mend the wall. So they work together only in Spring when they are mending wall. But once they have mended the wall, once they have made the fence, there is no relationship between the two neighbors. They never meet. So is it seriously true that good fences make good neighbor? We believe that good fences do not make good neighbors. Why they do not make good neighbors? Because once the fence is made, the relationship between the two people is broken. But once this wall falls down and both these neighbors get together on the Spring time, you know, to mend that wall, it is at that time that they become good neighbors. So how do they become good neighbors? We understand that they become good neighbors not by good fences, but by doing an activity together. And unfortunately, the activity that they do is they build a wall amongst themselves. So this good fence makes good neighbor itself says that it's not something tradition which we must stick to. So the person who is conforming with tradition has got its own doubts. Now, even if we take up the title of this poem, Mending Wall. Now, let's see this mending wall. If we take mending as a verb, we get the general meaning that most of you would know. Mending wall means ek diwar ko khada karna, usko theek karna, you know. A wall has broken down and we have to mend that wall. Mending is a verb and, you know, but there could be another thing also. Let's look at mending as an adjective. Now, if we take mending as an adjective, what happens? Mending wall, a wall that mends the relationship. A wall that mends the relationships. So what is mending wall about? Mending wall is not about non-conformity of tradition versus conformity of tradition. It is about a wall which leads to an activity of two people, and that activity of two people brings two people together, and when the two people come together, they mend their relationship. They become good neighbors. So mending wall, instead of becoming an act where verb mending is as a verb, suddenly changes the whole perspective of the poem. Now, this is what deconstruction teaches us to do. What it teaches us basically, it teaches us to destabilize the accepted existing notion about a thing, about a sentence, about a text. And it may.
Sir, your voice is not coming. Hello, Tanvir sir. Wait for us some time. Hello, Tanvir sir, are you getting me?
Unfortunately, I lost the contact.
Time back. Okay, no, sir, continue.
Thank you. Now, again, what I was talking about, I was repeating a statement that if you go back to, you know, Google and type the themes of Mending Wall, there would not be a single search result which would tell you that in Mending Wall, mending is an adjective and Mending Wall is about a wall which actually mends the relationship of two neighbors by engaging them in an activity which makes them good neighbors. Rather, everyone would talk about non-conformity of tradition and conformity of tradition. But if we take up this deconstructionist idea and these deconstructionist thought are this theory into account, what we would be able to do, we would be able to come out of that slumber of, you know, reading the summaries and the existing themes of the text and would look upon a text from absolutely different perspectives. Now, since we have been successful in breaking down this existing or stable notion or stable thing in this poem, what would be the new tensions? Now, the new themes that we would now talk about, as I said one earlier, that it is about a wall, a mending wall, which actually mends the relationships, which makes good friends, not, you know, by building a wall, but by the act of building that wall. Another would be like subjective versus objective. We would here say that this is a poem wherein we have more subjective opinions, and those subjective opinions come mostly from the speaker, isn't it? So it's about that. We would look it from that person, that perspective also. We would look at wall versus activity, as I said earlier. It's a wall and its activity. What makes good neighbors? Wall makes good neighbor, or the activity of mending wall makes a good neighbor. We can look at this poem from that perspective also. Now there is another thing that we can look at, is primitive versus science. What is primitive versus science? If you remember, there is a sentence in this poem, you know, he refers to his neighbor as a savage, you know, who is holding the stones in his hand and, you know, coming with full enthusiasm to mend this wall. He calls him as primitive. You know, wandering into the dark ages. He says that these dark shades are not the shades of the forest all only. You know, they are the dark shades in his head also. So this poem would also be talking about a tradition which was very prevalent back in the 19th century, where there were people who would confront science. You know, when the science was developing, this technology was developing, we may say that this wall could be an obstacle, not between the two neighbors only, but this could be an obstacle in the thought process of the people, which protects people from accepting or advancing in scientific and technological fields. Now, that was Application of Deconstruction on Mending Wall by Robert Frost. This way, we can look upon a text through different perspectives, through different ways, through different ideas, and come up with something novel, come up with something new, and just, you know, avoid the redundant reading of the text that we have all been doing. That is all that we have in today's webinar. We discussed deconstructionist theory and applied it on a text. Thank you for a patient listening. Over to the coordinator of this program, Anuj.
Thank you, sir, for such an inspirational lecture, and to deliver that how meaning in a language at every level is going to be deconstruct. So your lecture will enhance the faculty as well as the budding research scholars, and will also provide them an international podium. Now, the platform is open for the question. But before that, I request all that one by one, you can ask question, or also you can raise your hands.
Two participants have raised hands. Amit Kapoor, sir, you can unmute yourself. I would love to listen.
Okay. Firstly, I'd like to thank the organizers for organizing such a session. And secondly, I would like to congratulate Tanvir, sir. I had this second opportunity of listening to him. He seems to have mastered these theories. And it was a well-researched paper, I should say, well-researched presentation. I don't have a question as such, but while you were discussing, you know, we're giving a deconstructionist reading of Robert Frost's poem, I was just trying to connect it to the present situation of this pandemic. And I was trying to connect it in the way that just as the narrator in the poem says that good walls are needed, you know, to keep yourself probably good friends. So these days it would be like, if you want to see your neighbors alive and safe and healthy, you should keep physical distancing from them. So I was trying to connect it that way. And secondly, you know, the way in which this wall has been presented as a very important symbol in the poem, I feel, as you rightly said towards the end of your presentation, this mending wall is actually a symbol for the mental blocks for all those people who were at that point in time when this poem was written, were reluctant to accept the modernity, the modern thought. And so it becomes so effective, and that is why it becomes a highly anthologized poem by one of the greatest New Englanders, Robert Frost. So he has many other poems to his account, but then it was a well-researched kind of paper. So I just wanted to share this with you, that I was just thinking of connecting it with the present situation, right? Thank you so much.
So good masks make good neighbors in COVID-19 era.
Oh, yes, right.
I'd like Basharat sir to unmute their audio and would listen. We have, I think, Mirza Zaryab, who was raising hand, if you have a query. If there is any participant who has a question or any add-on, can unmute themselves. Anuj, it seems that we do not have questions from the participants. So I think you can go over to the principal, Bisharat sir.
Hello, Bisharat sir.
Unmute yourself, sir. Unmute.
Hello, sir. Are you hearing me, Bisharat sir?
Unmute me, hearing me.
Hello, sir. Sir, unable to connect with him. Anybody who would like to ask question?
Basharat sir, if you can unmute. Yes, now you have unmuted yourself.
Tanveen, congrats to you. I mean, it was a very good presentation. Keep it up.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Hello, Basharat sir, are you hearing me?
Basharat sir ka audio नहीं चल रहा है. इनसे कहें कि अगर ये अपने अपना headphone निकाल दें और headphone के बिना जो है वो बोलें. You know, to unmute yourself and remove the headphones.
Okay, okay.
I think he has heard.
Hello.
Basharat sir, unmute kare.
Hello.
Yes, sir. We are getting you.
Yes, sir. Now this has been a very very enlightening session by our expert. The views he has expressed were really enlightening as well as informative. The subject taken by him was really awakening subject. The concept of deconstruction as far as the relationship of the subject and the language is concerned. The way he has demonstrated things was really highly great. The way he has explained things by referring to the great poem by the great writer Robert Frost. It was really a source of inspiration for all of us. Every line he has analyzed under the shade of the subject he has taken. It was really something something inspirational. Although I have been reading Robert Frost in the years gone by, but the way he has described it and redefined certain concepts by the dint of his research work and by observing and by his original study of the text and reflecting upon certain important areas as far as language and the text of the poem is concerned. I am highly thankful and I am highly grateful to my expert student as well as my colleague, the way he has given us a very enlightening lecture, a very beautiful explanation and beautiful demonstration of a very difficult subject. The subject should not be the subject he had taken. It was not very easy to explain, very easy to demonstrate, but the way he has demonstrated it, the way he has made it very pliant and communicative for all of us, he deserves a huge round of applause. I wish him best of luck in the future years, because he has still a long way to go. Now we have played our innings, we are heading towards the culmination of our career. But the way he has started his career is really great, and it will end on a very, 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 very informative note. I hope that he continues with his style of research work he is doing in the subject, and I hope that he'll continue to compose very informative notes and books regarding the subject he has taken, or the other branches of the subject, not only poetry but other areas of the subject which are unlimited, of course. I hope that he will continue with this, and the student community across the world will get benefited because of his very great and prolific lectures he has delivered, and he has just given a proof of that by talking about deconstruction as far as Mendingwall is concerned. Mendingwall, I may tell you very sincerely, was really a confusing subject for me when I was a student at university level. I could not understand it properly. But now, today, to my entire satisfaction, the way he has explained it, and in the modern meaning, in the modern under the light of the modern research work, I am really impressed. Best of luck, my dear Tanveer. Hello.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. I express my words of thanks and my deep-rooted gratitude to Dr. Tanveer, who has just spared very valuable moments for all of us to give us something very important.
Sir, just a second. I would just like to tell everyone here that way back in 2006-07, when I was a student of Government Degree College, Bhadarwa, it was by one of the lectures by Basharat sir, who used to teach us English literature, which influenced me so much that in my career, I never filled any form. The only aim that I had was to be a teacher like Basharat sir.
No, sir. You have become the teacher of the teachers now. Let me be very plain. Let me be very clear about it. Now it is today. Without any exaggeration, I may tell you that it is today that I have learned the real meaning of Mendingwall.
But the inspiration has been Basharat sir.
No, sir. There have been so many people you might have come across, so many learned people you might have come across, and that are and those are equally inspirational for you. Now you have become a prolific writer as well as a prolific teacher, and your deliverance, I am deeply impressed with that. I am proud of you.
Thank you. We have Shafat Hussain is raising hand. I think Anuj, yes, Shafat.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Thank you so much for giving this opportunity, sir. And deconstruction was well expressed today. So I have a very small question, which I really want to, you know, basically relate this question to my subject, feminism. So what do you think about the feminism deconstruction of the opposition between man and woman today, sir?
Well, I think this deconstruction is very much required if you want to see it in the contemporary context when it comes to feminism. The most important thing that needs to be deconstructed here is that women need not to make man a standard. You understand? Whenever it comes to the feminism, the feminist would say that we are equivalent to man. Who is a man? Why do they want man as a standard for themselves?
Tanveer, sir, your voice is breaking. Wait for some time. Hello, Tanveer sir, are you getting me? Hello, Tanveer sir. Shifa sir, wait for a minute.
Yes, sir, for sure. Not an issue, sir. I know that it's, you know, we are running with 2G. So.
Yes, yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Hello, Tanvir sir.
Yes, yes, we had lost. We had lost the
Okay, okay, sir. Continue, sir.
So I was saying that when it comes to deconstruction of, you know, feminist thought, one thing that need to be deconstructed is looking at the standards of, you know, feminism. If the standard of a feminist writer or a theorist is that they want a female to be equal to men or like men, or that is one of the standards that needs to be broken. We are not a standard for the woman. And secondly, if you look at the second wave feminism or third wave feminism, you know, second wave feminism was the most brutal feminism that we had, you know, which mostly said that we would leave without, you know, for example, a man can leave without a woman can leave without a man. Well, that is another important aspect that we had in one of this brutal feminism, particularly in second wave feminism. So we need also to look at that. We complement each other. We are not the competitors of each other. As long as we complement each other, we make a society. So there are certain things, you know, which can be looked in feminism also, I think, can be reconstructed properly.
Tanvir, sir.
Yes, sir.
Sir, if you permit me, I would just like to add on, if you permit, what Mr. Yeah. Shafat is asking. I would just add to what he was asking. You know, he was asking something about how you could connect deconstruction with feminism. And I would like to say that you have, like in your presentation, Tanvir sir, you have focused on one of the key words of deconstruction, and that is breaking of the center of power, you know. From a theological, theocentric society, there is a shift to anthropological society, you know. So the shift, and because of that, there is a decentralization of power. So the center does not, like, you know, W.B. Yeats says, the center cannot hold. The center does not hold. And those who were there on the margins, like feminist writing, black writing, and see, diasporas and all, they started, the margins started moving towards the center. And that is why the world became topsy-turvy and things, you know, the tables turned, I would say. And that is how, you know, feminism is very much probably connected to deconstruction. It was about redefining power structures, like Foucault says. So that is what I just wanted to add.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you so much. I got the answer from the both speakers. And to be very frank enough, the session truly was awesome. And I appreciate the management as well, who really had put a lot of efforts to make it possible. So thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
I think, Anuj, you can end the meeting now. If you have any announcements towards the end, you can.
Sir, I think somebody else is here who want to ask you a question.
Please.
Ravindra Kumar.
Ravindra Kumar, sir.
Okay, no, this is something else. Let it.
Okay.
Hello?
Yes, yes, there is someone.
Hello?
Yes, sir, yes, sir.
Am I audible, sir?
Yes, yes, sir.
Sir, very good evening, sir. Sir, it was really one of the fabulous that is lecture that I have heard from you. And hello.
Yes, 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 sir.
And sir, really, for the first time I heard you. I have not met you, but I have talked to you a lot. If you remember, I'm also the head of the department in Itawa. And really, it was a very nice poem, the way you explained. Really, it was fabulous, and it was really an awesome lecture, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you.
Okay, now I would like to end the session. And so before that, I would like to extend my warm thanks to Professor Tanvir Ahmed for bearing our time with us. And your lecture, sir, not only enhanced the horizon of the scholars, but also orient them and help them practically that how to use the applications, theories, application of theories in a text, because most of the scholars are confronting with this problem, that how to use. So hopefully your explanations, your demonstrations will help them. So again, I thank you. And I also extend my warm thanks to the participants to bear time with us and to be a part of this webinar. So thank you to all. Thanks.